A woman's worst nightmare is when she puts on a brand new pair of pantyhose to do a beautiful speech like this, and they run. Not that you'd notice, but. Good morning, and welcome to the 20th Annual Tax and Estate Planning Seminar. I am Amy Millman, and I am the president of BNY Mellon's Wealth Management here in Northern California. And we are so proud to sponsor today's event, which celebrates the 20th anniversary. I can't believe it's 20 years of a tax seminar. I'm also a member of the Federation's Finance and Administration Committee, a Lion of Judah, and a donor to the annual campaign. The education, inspiration, and networking that this day provides is phenomenal. It provides phenomenal resources for our philanthropic, our professional community. The Federation's without a doubt one of the professional community's most useful resources. So thank you for joining us for a memorable day of learning and professional development. I'd now like to present Joy Sisisky, who is the Chief Philanthropy Officer of the Jewish Community Federation and Endowment Fund. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me here today. And thank you to Amy and BNY Mellon Wealth Management for sponsoring today's tax and estate planning seminar. I want to welcome you all to the anchor program of an important and meaningful day of philanthropic education. Day of Philanthropy is our signature event, and we're expecting more than 500 people today. So we're really looking forward to something exciting. Your role in supporting philanthropy is really crucial to the functioning of our community. And with your professional partnership, the Federation becomes even more effective at doing what we do, which is leveraging philanthropy and partnering with donors and organizations to make positive impact in our community. And we are effective in this mission because we have a really unique combination of stability and change, which sounds a little funny when you put those two together, but we have 106 years of experience and roots in this community and have been a part of the foundation, construction, and innovation of the Bay Area Jewish community. We have grown, changed, and engaged in new ways over the years, but have learned to be nimble at the same time to meet the needs of our donors and our community simultaneously. Just two examples of what we're doing today. We're seed funding innovative organizations that are inspiring new generations of Jews to find meaning in Jewish life, like The Kitchen, Jemena, and JFI, as well as helping nonprofits generate earned income revenue to become more sustainable on their own. And we're embarking on a major community portrait of Bay Area Jews and Jewish life that will be a game changer for organizations who serve our community, and it's the first community study that's been done in more than a decade, so really needed, and we're looking forward to launching that this fall, and the results, which we'll be excited to share at a Day of Philanthropy in 2018. Your work in concert with ours is about creating and solidifying legacy, the legacy of people, families, and traditions in order to benefit our donors and the community. So thank you so much to all of our sponsors today. Thank you to Amy. Thank you to our speakers. Thank you to the professionals who have organized this. I'd like to turn the program over to Ellen Kahn, who is the co-chair of the Professional Advisors Network, a preeminent trust and estate planning professional, and a terrific volunteer with our Jewish community. And I hope you really enjoy your day of learning, and thank you so much for coming.
Good morning, everyone. It's nice to see you so bright and early. It's my great pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker this morning, David Handler, and I've had the pleasure of hearing David the last couple years at Heckerling, and so we are all really in for a wonderful treat this morning. Just some background about David. David is from Chicago. He's a partner at Kirkland and Ellis. He focuses his practice on trust and estate planning and administration. He represents owners of closely held businesses, principals of private equity and venture capital funds, executives, families of significant wealth, and he establishes and administers private foundations, public charities, and tax-exempt entities. He has a long list of accomplishments, including he is a fellow of ACTEC. He's a member of the NAEPC Estate Planning Hall of Fame as an accredited estate planner. He's been recognized by Chambers, Best Lawyers in the USA. He's a Illinois super lawyer. And many of us read him regularly in Trusts and Estates magazine, where he is on the editorial advisory board, and he writes the monthly tax update column, which he has done for more than 10 years. David has authored many articles, many of which I'm sure we have read. He has co-written an ebook on estate planning, and he is regularly quoted in the Wall Street Journal and New York Times. David's a graduate of Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois, and received his undergraduate degree with highest honors from the University of Illinois. David, we're very grateful that you came out to join us from Chicago today. Please join us. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, thanks for having me. All I can say is, if this was in New York, it would not be at 8 a.m. They get up at 9:30. When I work out of the office there, I'll be in the office by 8 o'clock or so. And the secretaries don't even roll in until 9:30. But it's a pleasure to be here. I hope I've got some interesting material for you. I was glad my material's still here. I was commenting earlier, I once put my materials down on the podium half hour before I spoke somewhere, and when I got to the podium to speak, it was gone and nowhere to be found. So I turned to someone in the audience. I said, can I borrow your materials? Didn't have any notes, but hopefully it went fine. So I'm going to be talking in this first session about trust design and designing trusts. And one of the problems with trusts is I think they've been somewhat commoditized, in that, you know, I'll get a call once in a while, you know, we need a trust for the insurance, you know, just, you know, put one together. And then I'll jokingly say, does it matter who the beneficiaries are? Can I put my kids in? Anything in particular you want to do? But these trusts, you know, we talk about all these strategies and how to transfer wealth and gifts and sales and grants and everything else. At the end of the day, where they end up is in these trusts. And the trusts are the pieces that are here for the long haul. These may be 10, 20, 50, 100-year, 1,000-year trusts, perpetual trusts, whatever that means. I found it interesting where some states drew the line. Colorado said 1,000 years, that's it. And Florida said 360 should do the trick. I think the trusts sometimes get short shrift, and they really need to be designed for flexibility. They need to be designed for the fact that we don't know what the kids are going to be like, and we don't know what the grandkids are going to be like. We don't know what the world is going to be like. The other day, I was talking to one of my partners who was thinking about getting a new car, and I said, you might want to lease instead of buy, because there'll all be self-driving cars in 4 years. No one's going to want yours. Your car doesn't drive itself. You know, the trade-in value is going to be down to zero. But if you think about it, 4 years ago, we weren't talking about that. Now, they still owe us flying cars. Those were promised to us many, many years ago. But we don't know what's going to be in terms of the economy, in terms of assets, in terms of where people are going to live, what they're going to be like, what their situations are going to be. So we need flexibility. And so I'm going to be talking about, first, some provisions that can add flexibility. And then I'm going to turn to some specific clauses that, in my view, should be in most, if not every, trust that may not be in the ones you're seeing. So first and foremost, building flexibility in the trust, to me, comes down to who can appoint and remove trustees. When everything else, putting everything else aside, you have a discretionary trust, a trust for ascertainable standards, whatever the terms are, you have a trustee, and they're the ones who are managing the assets, making the decisions on a day-to-day basis, deciding what support means. We always get that question from our clients. So what's support? And then I say, well, we know what support is. We just don't always know what support isn't. You know, is it the third house? I don't know. Is it the yacht? Well, it depends. Do you normally have a yacht? What about the fourth house? Well, you only had three in the past. So, but it's the trustee provisions, I think, that matter the most. Who is that person? So it's not so much who is that person, but who gets to pick that person and who can remove that person? Who is going to appoint and remove trustees? And so, number one, don't ever have a merely fixed list of trustees, A, then B, then C. I mean, you can have that in your trust documents, because our clients say, this is who I want in this order, but it can't stop there, because inevitably, they will say, why in the world did I ever put B? What were you thinking? They'll turn to their spouse. and C, we don't like anymore, and D is dead. So much for our fixed trustee list that we put in place years ago. So we need to plan for that. They can have the initial list, but how are we going to change it? So what we do is we empower people to appoint trustees, empower people to remove trustees, and there's a list. So in a typical document I would have is the grantor can appoint and remove trustees, and again, subject to the limitations on appointing and removing. The grantor's spouse can appoint and remove, and maybe they're together on that line, so jointly they can do it. Then the kids can do it for their own trusts if they're 30 years old or 40 years old or whatever age the client chooses. And, well, let's say the kids are 90 and they're incapacitated. Okay, the kids' children can appoint the trustees for their parents. And just have this list. But we go on to make it even more flexible. We allow people on the list to change the list. So if you're here on the list, you're the grantor or the grantor's spouse, you can change the people below. So you know when we put 35 for the kids being able to appoint their trustees? Scratch that out and make it a 49. Or for child number three, it's a never. But empowering people to appoint trustees. So it's not so important who you name, but it's who can do it. And having that being a flexible list, because it's going to change over time. We also allow, when you trustees are appointed, it says they can be appointed for specific roles and purposes. So, okay, you're going to vote the stock and you're going to make distribution decisions. Or we're going to specify the terms and conditions. You can only be trustee until you're 92. After that, you're out. Or you can be trustee if this happens. So if I die first and this happens. So we can build in all of that, build in the flexibility in the trust document. Because inevitably it comes up. The client will ask you 20 years later, so can we do this? I want to appoint this person as successor trustee, but only if this, and then I want this person to do it. And by the way, we want our brother-in-law to pick successor trustees for the kids on a go-forward basis. And we can do that. We're not changing the terms of the trust. We're not changing the beneficiaries. We're not changing the distribution provisions. We're just changing the mechanics of who can be and not be the trustee. And that's not going to cause any estate inclusion problems by doing that. It's more of an administrative, mechanical provision. Sometimes we'll include or authorize people to impose qualifications on trustees. So they can impose qualifications in the future. They have to be family members, for example. Or they have to be family members or non-family with at least 10 years experience in certain fields, law or accounting or financial or otherwise. Then I always laugh and I say, just because you've been doing something for 10 years doesn't mean you're any good at it, but or just because you're a family member doesn't mean you'd be a good trustee by any means, which is often true. But if they want to impose some limitations or restrictions, we can build that in the trust document. And again, it doesn't seem like something the client would necessarily want on day one, but 20 years later, 30 years later, or when you're talking with their kids and they've got their own trusts and now they're the ones who are the clients. Wait, why did they do that? And they named Uncle Joe as the trustee? We hate Uncle Joe. He hates us. So here's who we want as our trustees, or here's who we want to appoint for our children, and here's the appropriate age we think our kids should be able to pick their own trustees. You know, they put 30. We think it should be 40. So building that into the trust document, I think, is number one as far as flexibility. Also, allowing beneficiaries to be co-trustees. So I'm a strong believer in giving control at some point. Again, there's a million exceptions to that. Some people should never have control. But at some point in time, age 30, 40, 50, whatever it is, at some point they need to sort of be given the keys. They are who they are. Don't blame us. It's your fault, client. I tell clients, my documents aren't going to fix your kids. You had 25 years to raise them, and whatever I write isn't going to undo any of that. And so either give them control or don't give them control at a certain point in time. And you can give them quite a bit of control. So the beneficiary, they can be a co-trustee. They can have power to distribute to themselves and their kids for health, education, support, and maintenance. They can have a co-trustee who can make broader distributions. So we often bifurcate that. So the good news to the kids is, look, for 99% of what you're going to need, you can make those decisions yourself. You can be the sole trustee for those distributions, and it'll say that in the trust. And then your co-trustee over here is only for anything else, the discretionary distributions, that's for the yacht and for the charitable contribution you want to make or whatever it may be. And they can have a power to appoint a co-trustee sort of if needed. They should be independent, shouldn't be a beneficiary. I recommend they don't be related or subordinate either. But you can have this flexibility, you can have this bifurcated trust with giving them control at some point, yet having the flexibility. And I find, you know, I think that's the genesis of all this decanting, because we have all these trusts out there that say health, education, support, and we want to get a bunch of money out for some reason. I'm working with a client now, her husband passed away, we have $50 million in a marital trust, a non-GST-exempt marital trust. She wants to do some planning. In fact, she wants to do some planning before these new 2704 regs come into play. Well, can we justify distributing $25 million out on the basis of support, especially since it's closely held stock? It's not going to support her. But if we have a discretionary standard, if we've got a co-trustee who can make a discretionary distribution for any purpose, there we go. Now we can, and which is what we're doing. We're decanting and we're creating a trust that's going to have that authority, which we can do in Illinois. So having that co-trustee, or even if they're the sole trustee, discretionary distributions are invaluable. There's going to be a reason we're going to want it, whether it's for planning, for charitable giving, for whatever the situation, it's the situations that we can't foresee. I often like to include what I'll call an administrative trustee. So we all know that when we name the client's brother or sister or cousin as the trustee for the minor kids, we're not doing them any favors. We don't tell them that. Hey, would you mind being the trustee? Just sign here. But if they were to ask the right questions, they'd run. It's a job. There's liability. Yeah, your nieces and nephews may or may not sue you, but they might. And you're supposed to be doing some things. And included in those are sometimes just the administrative tasks of keeping the records. When they are turned 18 or 25 or whatever age, and they say, oh, I've got a trust. Thanks for finally telling me. And can I get an accounting? Accounting? You know, I don't have any of that. So having an administrative trustee, often a bank, many of the banks and trust companies will serve in this role, even if not a full trustee. They'll keep custody of the assets. They'll keep the records. They'll give the crummy notices. They'll do all the things that the client, that the trustees are supposed to be doing that we know they're not. And they'll basically keep the trust running the right way. They're gonna save the friend or cousin from liability at the end of the day. By having them as a co-trustee. And in my materials, I've got a list of some of the powers I give them, administrative trustees. And we'll often use them if we want to use Delaware law, for example, and we don't really want the Delaware trustee to do everything, and maybe they don't want to do everything. They don't want to touch the closely held concentrated position. Maybe we'll have an administrative trustee in Delaware, so we have our nexus, we can have a perpetual trust or whatever other laws we're seeking to use. And so we give them the authority to maintain all the bank accounts and brokerage accounts and custody of the assets, maintain trust records, maintain an office for meetings, facilitate and prepare accountings, execute documents, and the like. So we've got a list of functions, and you can add to that. So another way I like to give control and flexibility is to bifurcate the trustee roles. And some states have been more explicit than others, so some have enacted directed trust statutes saying you can do this, you can have a trustee that does this, you can have a trustee that does that, one that directs investments, one that directs distributions. Other states haven't been as explicit by calling it a, quote, directed trust statute, but most states say these are the rules in absence of the trust agreement to the contrary. In other words, the trust agreement can govern. Well, if the trust agreement can govern, including setting forth the roles and responsibilities of the trustees, well, doesn't that mean I can have trustee A has these roles and responsibilities and trustee B has those roles and responsibilities? So even without the directed trust statute, you can draft a trust that way and say this person does this, this person does that. But you need to be clear. It can't be this is their authority. It also needs to say this is their authority, and they have no responsibility for the other job. And so this trustee is responsible for investments, and by the way, they have no responsibility or authority over distributions and vice versa. Otherwise, okay, we can do this, but do I still have to do that? I am a, quote, trustee. So one thing I like to do, the grantor of the trust could be the investment trustee. So there's cases, and I cite them in here, Old Colony Trust Company, Supreme Court case, the King case was from the tax court. Number of cases have all said administrative powers are not the type of powers that will cause inclusion in the estate under 2036. So I can't be the trustee of the trust I create and control distributions. But I can manage the investments with the caveat, the 2036B, if there's closely held stock, voting stock, I can't vote that stock. I don't want to touch anything having to do with life insurance on my life, so we carve those two things out. But I can manage the investments of the trust. I can be the investment trustee. I can deal with all of that, which takes everyone else off the hook for it, puts me back on the hook. But we can also give the power to the beneficiaries as well at some point. So when we get to the point where we say, child, you're now 35, you can be trustee of your trust, you can make the health, education, support distributions without the co-trustee. We've got another trustee over here who can make discretionary distributions. But normally the trustee's job, the two of them, would be to manage the investments. We can carve that out as well. We can say, and beneficiary, you'll also be the sole investment trustee. So this person who's here doing you a favor more than anything else, they don't have to worry about most of the distributions. They don't have to worry about managing the investments because we've exonerated them, said that they have no power or authority whatsoever for managing those investments. And again, we can carve out more powers. And we can have these same structures, again, with directed trusts. These statutes allow just saying the same thing in a different manner. So another fiduciary often put in trusts is often referred to as a trust protector. And there's been many articles, and I always scratch my head because I read the article to see, so how is this person defining trust protector? Because there is no definition. It's whatever you want it to be. I don't know where the name came from, but I know trust protectors have been given powers as broad as the power to amend the trust. You can change the beneficiaries, you can change the terms of the trust. I rarely would use a trust protector for that purpose, ever given that power, for a few reasons. One, the client struggled to come up with a trustee. Now you're going to say, so we need to know the name of a person who's not the trustee, who can rewrite all this stuff that we just spent 6 weeks working on, when you're not here, by the way. So they can change the beneficiaries, they can change the terms of the trust. Really? Who in the world would I give that power to? I just gave you my number one player to be the trustee, and by the way, I gave you my number two and number three as my backup trustees, and now we need someone who's gonna have that kind of power. The other problem with it is, as soon as you tell the client, by the way, you can give someone a power to amend this trust, so if you change your mind next week or next year, they're going to think of it as a revocable trust. Every time they change their revocable trust, they're going to call you up and say, oh, and by the way, change all those other trusts too for the kids. And what will happen is, over their lifetime, there will be this pattern, and the IRS will one day say, wait a minute, you have this irrevocable trust with 19 amendments. And they happen to coincide with every amendment you made to your revocable trust, it's not going to look like a revocable trust. I think it's going to fall apart. And as soon as you open that door a crack, we know the clients walk through it. You say, oh, I can do that? Well then, you know, where's the limit? There is no limit in their minds. What I do like to give is what I'll call cleanup powers. And I think you can give these powers to the trustee. The power to amend the trust, to make changes, to adjust to changes in the tax law. Changes in state law. So we're not rewriting the trust. You can't change the trust terms. You can't change the beneficiaries. But if adding a comma somewhere in the back or throwing in the word not or adding a new sentence or a new power to invest in some investment that doesn't yet exist. So those are more technical administrative type powers. And we can give the trustee the power to do that or give a third party the power to do that. And I've got some sample language here in the material. For our pages are the same, page six. So trust protector can have powers to amend to realize intended tax consequences. So this is what we meant. The rules have changed, so let's now fix it. Change in the code, change in state law. Expand, limit, or modify the powers of a fiduciary other than the powers to make payments to the beneficiary. So we're not changing the heart of the trust. We're changing the latter half of the trust. Flexibility, another form is from limited or special powers of appointment. So these are powers you can give to the beneficiaries to change where the trust goes when they're gone, for example. So a marital trust could say when the spouse is gone, they have the power in their will to direct how the trust will be divided among the children, children and grandchildren, or anyone they want. And that's always a discussion we have with the client. So how broad should this power be? I always highly recommend at a minimum the descendants. you don't know what the situation will be. Suddenly, you know, this child isn't talking to you, and this one's on drugs, and by the way, we like the grandkids better anyway. So, or we need to change the terms. We're not necessarily cutting anyone out, but circumstances have changed. And so we can revise, in effect, the document through the power of appointment. And so this can be given to the spouse, the surviving spouse. This can be given to the children. To me, that's the most important. Again, we don't know what the grandkids are going to be like, or the great-grandkids, or what circumstances, or what is going to happen with them, whether financially or physically, disability or otherwise. Someone needs more or less money. Someone's going through a divorce lawsuit. We need to do something different with their trust. So giving them those powers of appointment is very important. I strongly encourage my clients to let their kids appoint at least a portion of their trust to the kid's spouse. Because I see the scenario, and I try to paint it to them, and it's hard for them to see when the kids are 8 years old, like we don't even know who the spouse is, no. Let's assume the kids live a long life, and they're married for 50 years, and their spouse is great, and suddenly they're hit by the bus, and the trust goes down to the kids, and the spouse is saying, now what do I do? Because this was a great source of our income and our wealth. And the child's hands are tied. They didn't even have the power to leave assets to the spouse. So I encourage, look, at least allow them to leave it in trust for the spouse. Let them do half in trust for the spouse. Do something here because you may want it, and it may have tax benefits. So it may be a non-GST exempt trust. It's going to trigger tax when the child dies. If they can appoint it to a marital trust, we can defer the tax and benefit the spouse at the same time. So again, build these powers into the trust. And then it's not just enough to say you have a power of appointment in favor of spouses and descendants and charities or whoever you include, but say it can be exercised outright or in further trust. One thing I've done more recently is sometimes we'll want to exercise a power during life. And the concern there is, so I've got a trust for my benefit and I exercise my power to a trust for my kids. Did I make a gift? And there's rulings about that, and basically the answer is who knows. It's uncertain depending on the terms. So I've included a provision saying you can exercise in favor of another trust, and you can retain the same power of appointment over that new trust. So if the IRS were to say, David, you made a gift when you moved $1 million from your trust to your kid's trust, the gift would actually be incomplete for gift tax purposes if I retain that same power of appointment. And by the way, that has some practical benefit. I can still tinker with it. So I build that in, but we need to have that in the trust document. So another open issue is, talking about generation skipping tax. So the child has a trust for their benefit. It's not generation GST exempt. So if they pass away, it's going to go to their kids. And the question is, do we give them a general power of appointment so it's included in their estate, and then there's no GST tax? Or do we not give them a general power of appointment? It won't be in their estate, and then there is GST tax. And which one is better? And I used to think, the answer is always give them a general power because the GST tax is always at the highest estate tax rate. The estate tax rate could be lower. In the past, it was. Now it's not. And that just seemed the better way. But I think the answer has changed, especially since the law has changed and some states don't have we used to have the pickup estate tax. So the answer is it depends. First, what are the beneficiaries' own assets? Do they have a large estate of their own? If they do, they're using their estate exemption up already. So does it really matter which one we subject it to? Where do they live? Are they in a state where there's a state estate tax? If there is, we don't want a general power of appointment. We'd rather have a GST tax because there's one tax instead of two. But the problem is they may move. No, they don't live in a state with an estate tax today. Next week they do, 20 years later they do. So depends on the size of their own estate. Obviously it depends on the size of their trust. Depends on where they live, if there's a state estate tax. Now one thing that has really been removed, the issue of basis step up won't matter. So if they have a general power of appointment, it's included in their estate, the assets will get a basis step up. They'll also get a basis step up if it's not. If it's subject to GST tax, a taxable termination triggered by death gets a basis step up under the GST tax rules. So it works the same way if there's a taxable termination, so they die, the trust terminates, goes down to kids, that gets a basis step up just like the general power, the inclusion would get a step up. So the basis issue is a non-issue. But the problem is, you know, so right now we say, well, the kid's 20 years old, he has no assets, so we should give him a general power. Well, 30 years later, he could be a billionaire, and now we don't want a general power. So what do we do? I put in my documents, the default is they have a general power in favor of creditors of their estate, so technically he's included in their estate. But I give the trustee the power to remove the general power, and only upon the request of the beneficiary. Because what trustee, how would the trustee know when to do it? Well, I need to know when you're going to die, what your wealth will be, and where you're going to live. And if you can tell me those three things, then I know what the answer is. And so I don't want to give the trustee, and the trustees don't want, the responsibility to figure that out. They get, hey, why didn't you take away their general power before he died? Well, I didn't know I was supposed to do that. So let's give the trustee the power to do it, but only at the request of the beneficiary. Otherwise, it's not even a power that they have. And then they can figure out what the best thing to do is. Dividing trusts. So I saw about a month ago a new client. They sent us a copy of their documents. They have this great big trust. They made all their gifts there, and it's for the benefit of the kids and the grandkids and the great-grandkids, and it's just, and when the rule against perpetuities runs out or the descendants run out, then it goes to charity. And I just shook my head. It's just bad idea. Having multiple siblings, let alone first cousins and nieces and nephews and aunts and uncles sharing out of the same bank account is not a good idea. Just imagine right now if you had to go to your siblings and say, okay, let's pool all of our money together. You know, it sounds a little socialistic, and some will say, well, yeah, but you spend too much and you invest too aggressively, and that's exactly what would happen in this situation. So I strongly believe in dividing trusts. I think that makes sense when you're building the wealth and the kids are minors. Yeah, let's use a single trust perhaps and build it up and allow for discretionary distributions among them. But at some point, let the trust divide. When the parents are gone, divide into three trusts for each of the kids. Let them go their own direction. Invest it differently. Spend differently. What you do is what you do. What I do is what I do. Pick our own trustees and have different people. And they may be under different circumstances, again, in different states as well. But I also, the concern, you know, even just take a normal life insurance trust, which we might use for other purposes, and maybe they cancel the insurance, and now it's got a whole bunch of money in it anyway. And the trust says it divides when the grantor and the grantor spouse are both gone. Well, they lived to age 95, the kids are 70, and they finally get the trust to divide, and they get their own trust. So I like building in more flexibility. Allow the trustee to divide it earlier. If the spouse is a beneficiary, maybe with the spouse's consent or veto or something like that. But there may be a point where everyone's saying, why isn't this dividing? We don't need the money. You guys need the money. Not that we can't distribute it, but we don't necessarily want to distribute it. We just like to go our own directions and invest in what we want to invest in. So allow for this dividing of trusts earlier, perhaps, than at the grantor's death or grantor's and grantor's spouse's death. So I talked before about discretionary distributions, how important they are. In our documents, we say sole and absolute discretion, equally or unequally, considering or ignoring the beneficiary's other resources, and to or for their benefits. So we can pay their bills or we can give them money. The only thing we haven't said in the document is, and we mean it. We deliberately don't use the word best interests. Because then you get into, well, is this in your best interests? Well, it's in my, you know, any beneficiary will say, it is in my best interest to have money. What beneficiary wouldn't say that? So where's the line drawn? So if you really want the trustee to have discretion to make distributions, you need to say you have discretion, not, well, what's in the beneficiary's best interest? Because then you get, now you're in a standard. It may not be an ascertainable standard on the code and state law, but now you have a rule here that can be litigated. So if you say sole and absolute discretion for any purpose whatsoever, equally or unequally, consider or ignore their other resources, that's true discretion for the trustee. I also like to include what we call an advancement provision. So let's say we have this trust. It's a single trust. It hasn't divided yet. One of the kids is now 30 years old. One of the kids is 21, still in school, and you know, we'll throw in it's a second marriage, and we got a 14-year-old in the mix as well. And so we've got this big age span, and the trust isn't going to divide until they're all through school, for example, or some other event occurs. the 30-year-old saying, look, I've got a family and career and I'd like to buy a house, and the trustee's saying, well, we have the money, but if I give you $500,000, $1 million, whatever it is to buy a house, that's coming out of your sibling's share. And they're not gonna be very happy if I give you that much. You know, if I give you $20,000 here and there, that's one thing. So the trustee might say, I'm not gonna do it. But if we have what I call an advancement provision, it gives the trustee the ability to say, yeah, I'll give you that million, but I'm marking that down. That's gonna count as an advancement against your future share. So it's not gonna be $333,000 out of your sibling shares down the line. You're gonna get $1 million less later on. And I think it makes everyone happy. Older child gets the money, younger children aren't reduced in what they're gonna get in the future. I don't go to the extreme and build in an interest component. Oh, they got the money 20 years before I got the money. I think that opens the door to, you know, well, what's the right interest rate to charge? And meanwhile, the assets grew faster or slower. But again, for flexibility. Even good old crummy annual withdrawal rights, building in flexibility on those. So it says if a gift is made, the beneficiaries have a right to withdraw up to the annual exclusion amount. Give the trustee or give the donor the power to change that. So, oh, one of the kids actually took the money. Scratch them out. They no longer have a right of withdrawal. No more gifts for that one. Or maybe we want to increase the amount. They change the rules. Who knows? So power to increase or decrease the amount subject to withdrawal at the time of the gift. So we've talked a lot about health, education, support, and sole discretion and all that. And we can write that in a million trusts. But then it comes time to actually administer the trust. And if you ask 20 people, what does this mean? You'll get 20 different answers. And if you ask 20 clients, so what do you mean by this? So is this a safety net if all else fails, otherwise you're on your own? Is this, hey, we've lived really well, I want you to continue living really well? And then define really well. Is that private jet really well, or is that, you know, you don't have a mortgage really well? Or There's lots of levels of living very well. And then we get the clients that say, oh, I know, we'll have incentive provisions. So if they work, we'll give them money. If they don't, they don't get money. And I hate those because I just don't even know where to begin with it, of all the exceptions to ask the client. I'll quickly just try to debunk it and say, okay, so the CEO child gets $1 million a year and the teacher child gets $50,000 a year as the matching incentive provision. That doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And by the way, when do they have to start working? What if they get a master's degree? Is it age 25? Is it 30? When can they stop working? Are we going to now dictate? So we'll match your income until age 65. So you can't stop working at 62. That won't do it. So there's just so many exceptions. And then you have, well, what if they can't work? What if they want to be a stay-at-home parent? Do you want to discourage that? What if they have a disability? What if their child has a disability or illness and they need to stay home and take care of them? There's so many things that you can't foresee. So to say, we'll give you money if you make money, is probably counter to what most people would really want in the vast majority of cases. And same thing with lifestyle requirements. So you have to finish college or you won't get any money. Well, I can give you a list of about 25 billionaires that did not finish college. And they left because they had a great opportunity, it came their way, they took it, and if they hadn't, they'd be sitting in this room with us taking notes. So I think they made the right choice. And so requiring these things, hard and fast rules, you have to do this, doesn't always make sense. And same thing with drug tests. There's if you Google the Rollins family, they own the Orkin pest control. If you Google them, you'll find a whole lot of articles about the turmoil in this $8 billion wealth family because they imposed all these restrictions and requirements on their kids. Some of their kids were in their 50s. And hired investigators to follow them and check on their drug tests. And it's just basically everyone's getting a divorce, everyone's getting in a lawsuit, and it's a big mess because, oh, we're going to have these strict tests and, you know, everyone's so holier than thou and, oh, you need to measure up. You're only in the arts. That was one of the situations. One of the kids, it's the arts, you know, where is that a profession? And so that child was getting very little, and then the one that was working in the company was getting a lot, and so it didn't work very well. Trustee guidance. So instead of incentive provisions, I like to give trustee guidance. So a page, page and a half, and I have our provisions right in here on pages 10 and 11 leading on to 12 of trustee. So far we've said discretionary distributions and health, education, and support. But in doing this, we want to encourage certain values and behaviors. That's really what we're trying to do. And you might encourage those behaviors or discourage those behaviors by using the trust funds. And it doesn't mean giving the money. It might mean not giving the money. So take the drug scenario. We want to discourage illegal drug use. Okay, we have that on our list. Does that mean we cut them off if they're using illegal drugs? No, it might mean we pay for them to be in rehab and we move them out of the neighborhood they're in. So it may be paying for some things, not cutting them off. It could have the opposite effect doing that. So I show this to clients and say, modify this, add to it, whatever you want to do, pursue an education, be gainfully employed, be a law-abiding member of society. So the trustee can say, look, you're doing all the right things, but we're bailing you out of jail every other month. This really wasn't the intent of the trust. Productive member of society. So all these things, we specifically make them precatory, not requirements. And you'll see in the language here, these are not requirements. And the geographical norms may be different, where you live and so forth. And by the way, we do value a stay-at-home parent, and we do value these other things. But trustee, take these into account as best you can. These are our values, as opposed to just leaving you with health, education, support, best of luck. And so some clients modify these, add to them. Some have added some religious things. We want you to be religiously observant or whatever that may. And I tell them, we've had some, we want them to, they have to do this. And I had one client, they have to observe Orthodox Jewish tradition. Define that. I'll get you 20 rabbis in the room and you'll get 20 answers there. So you can never satisfy that test. So just again, expressing this is what we'd like. We can't force it. And by the way, if you put those in and say you have to get a prenup, you have to do this, well, they might say, well, fine, I won't get married. Well, wait, we were trying to encourage marriage by doing this, but protecting the property, and now they're just going to not get married, and now they're not cut off. Wait, so now what? Or did you really mean to cut them off? Really? If they don't get a prenup, you really want them to get no money from this trust? Do you want to go to that extreme? Most clients will back off when you ask that. So turning to important but overlooked clauses on page 12. So even as basic as what I'll call the funding formulas in a will or revocable trust. So it's the formula that says at the first spouse's death, the credit shelter trust gets the maximum amount that without any estate tax, the marital trust will get the balance. And we have that formula. And let's assume the marital trust is a Q-tip marital trust, or elect or not elect treatment. You have to include a statement saying, and by the way, when you're doing this allocation, trustee, assume the marital trust is elected for the marital deduction. Otherwise, we don't know what goes where. The problem is there might be other marital trusts floating out there. So if the client gifted an insurance policy to an insurance trust and died within 3 years, it'll be included in their estate. Often the insurance trust has a contingent marital trust. If the person dies within 3 years, the insurance goes here, goes to this other marital trust. So when you have the revocable trust saying, $5.5 million to the credit shelter trust, balance to the marital trust. Well, it says the maximum amount. Well, depends. Do we assume that the Q-tip election is made for this other marital trust? If not, that used up the $5 million. If so, it didn't. Or same thing with the grat. The client dies during the existence of a grat. The grat term hasn't ended. It's included in their estate. Maybe they left the grat to a Q-tip trust. So again, we have the issue, how do we do the formula? We don't know what the assumption is over here on these other ones. So we've added to our formula to basically say the property of other marital trusts of property included in the grantor's estate will be assumed to qualify for the marital deduction as well. So then we have a formula we can work with. We need to assume an election or not otherwise we don't know how to administer that. I've got some sample language at the bottom. The divorce clause, this is the one I always bring up, you know, the last minute of the meeting when they're tired anyway and just want to get out, which is, I think, is 20 minutes into the meeting. The divorce clause is the clause I put in almost every document, but I highlight it and we'll do an outline of proposed terms of the document, which is the only thing the client ever really reads. And we've added this divorce clause to it to really highlight it. And it says, upon either spouse filing for divorce, not upon divorce, but upon filing, you're cut out. And by the way, your family's cut out too. So if they named, so the spouse is out, the parents are out, the siblings are out, if they were trustees, if they were beneficiaries, if they were anything, and that's what I think what most people would want or wouldn't bother getting a divorce. And we put that in revocable and irrevocable trusts. And we do it upon filing for a divorce because I've had two occasions where they didn't get around to changing their documents. It was effective upon divorce, and they died before the divorce is final. Some would say that's justice. So we want to kick out the whole family, but we've been asking more carefully that question, and especially when it comes to an irrevocable trust. So, and let's take a state like California. It was community property that went to that trust. So, you know, maybe one spouse thinks of it as his or hers. Hey, I made the money. Yeah, but it's community property. You can say what you want. You know, if I leave you, I'm walking with half. And so we have this divorce clause. So what do you mean I'm kicked out and my family's kicked out? Or even if it's not a community property, Illinois, I made a gift, $10 million. My wife elected to split the gift. I just used her gift exemption. So I use your gift exemption, and your family's kicked out if we're divorced, and your family gets to stay in. So it's become more of something we focused on. So what should the answer be? And I think the answer is, if you ask them both together, you'll get one answer, and that is nobody's cut out or everyone's cut out. And if you ask one spouse separately, then you'll get a very different answer. So we now only ask it together. But I think it's an important clause to have in there. And again, filing petition, we also have a provision saying, but if the petition's withdrawn and so forth and so on, then you're welcome back into the fold. But it does create some fairness, especially if the spouse is a beneficiary of the trust. So look, I'm not a beneficiary of the trust. You're not going to be one either if we divorce. It'll just be for the kids. And the vast majority agree on doing that. So speaking of children, just checking my time. So children born out of wedlock. Children and descendants. So we like to define almost every word in our document. You know, we haven't defined the word the yet or trust, but we're working on it. And so children, so who is that? Is that children of the grantor? Is that children of the marriage? So again, this goes to the same divorce situation. Or, hey, we funded this with community property. Or we used your gift exemption, or you split those annual exclusion gifts, or maybe I gave you the money to put in the trust in the first place. So what's the source? So if we divorce, okay, spouse, you're out. I created the trust. It says for my descendants. Oh, my descendants for the next four spouses. Is that what was really intended? We used your gift exemption, and now it's going to benefit the ex's future children with a future spouse. Another thing to put on the list to discuss with clients in the endless discussion of these terms. But so the question is, what should it be? Whose children should it be? And again, if you ask the question in front of both of them, it will be, yes, children of our marriage. And then, you know, one of them will call you later on, I really want it just my kids. But if we represent both, then that's that. Portability, so we have this, I guess, no longer new concept of portability in the law. So if a person dies, they didn't use up all their estate tax exemption, an election can be made by filing an estate tax return, so the surviving spouse can inherit, in effect, the unused exemption. But it only happens if they file an estate tax return. And maybe there isn't a reason to. It was under the threshold. It was under the threshold. They didn't have to do it. But the only way they'll get that exemption is by filing a full-fledged, you'd think they'd have, you know, the postcard version. Check the box, portability, yes, we're good. Note, you got to file a full thing, appraisals, and the whole nine yards. So if you want to do it, you might have an executor or trustee that says, I don't know, how's it going to benefit the beneficiary of the trust? I don't want to do it. I don't want to spend the time and money. So we've put in provisions saying, trustee, do it. Executor, do it. File a return if there's any exemption to be used so we can get the benefit of portability. Now, keep in mind, it's not the ideal. Portability has some downsides. One, the GST exemption isn't portable. That doesn't go with the estate exemption. And the other risk is there's no rule that they have to use that inherited exemption on your kids. So my wife passes away, I get her exemption, and let's say just I got the assets outright. Well, even I didn't get outright, I have her exemption. Now I take my assets and I make a gift to somebody else, and I can actually indicate on the gift tax return I'm using her exemption, not mine. Save mine for later. So there's no rule that it has to be used on the people the deceased spouse would have wanted it used on. So there's definite risks in the whole portability concept. But I guess the person who died won't know. Conduit trusts. So if you ever name a trust as a beneficiary of a retirement plan, it'll trigger the taxes over 5 years unless it is in a certain form and has certain provisions. The one I use is a so-called conduit trust. Basically, the trust has to say they can't have a power of appointment during life over the assets, and the required minimum distributions, I think, but MRD, it's RMD, or minimum required distributions, either way. So those distributions have to be taken by the trustee, which we'd want them to do anyway, and the trustee has to turn around and distribute them that year. So it has to be a conduit trust. We take the minimum distributions, we pay it out to the beneficiaries. Otherwise, it'll trigger, you can't defer the tax over the life expectancy. And you might say, so why bother with the trust if it's just coming in and coming out? Well, the trust still serves the benefit of they're only getting the minimum distributions unless the trustee decides to take more. If the trustee decides to take more out, they can, and then they have to pay that out. But they're serving as a gatekeeper, because you could have a 25-year-old beneficiary saying, oh, $1 million IRA, send me a check, I'll take the whole thing. Yeah, taxes and penalties, I'd rather have the cash. But if it was in a trust, the trustee will say, no, I'm going to dole this out just like the rest of the assets. And by the way, we shouldn't pull the money out of the IRA early. So I build it into every revocable trust because we don't know if they're going to name the trust as a beneficiary. Maybe they don't initially. They do later on. So just put it in the back of the document. Clause is saying, by the way, if this any trust is a beneficiary of a retirement plan, these are the rules that apply. Must distribute out. Must take out the minimum distributions and the like. And also, for a marital trust, you have the greater of the income or the minimum distributions. So change of situs in governing law. So again, changing world, changing landscape. Is governing law in California the best one? Well, what if none of the beneficiaries are here anymore and we could perhaps avoid, I know California is based on beneficiaries and trustees. Other states are based on other contexts. So if we can change the governing law, is that going to help? Or maybe we can take advantage of decanting by changing governing law to a state that allows it or has some new provision that is beneficial. So if we can give the trustees the power to change the governing law and or change the situs of the trust, there can be advantages. The one caveat there is, and you'll see it in my language, but any such change shall not affect the original term of the rule against perpetuities. So you can't, what we don't want to do is say governing law was California, now we moved it to Delaware, and Delaware has perpetual trusts, and now we just extended the trust, and now did we just mess things up for the trust, and is it invalid? Did we mess up GST? So I think you need to stick with the original rule against perpetuities. I've had a number of clients ask me, hey, can we move the trust over there and then make it perpetual? And the answer is no, because your trust says it cannot exceed this term, so you'd be violating your own trust. So back to my concept of I define every term on page 17, so health, education, support. Well, what's that mean? What does health mean? And I've had clients tinker with this. Some have been more restrictive. But so you see, construed liberally, all forms of mental and physical health care and dental care. I don't know why the dentist got a special line. Including at home, nursing home, assisted living, other extended care, elective procedures, and health and dental insurance. So health could be, hey, we'll pay your insurance. Health could be, we'll pay the expenses. We'll keep you in the home instead of a nursing home. Elective procedures, so that's where some clients, wait a minute, how elective are we talking? But that's a dangerous, most people think, oh, that's the plastic surgery for, you know, enhancement, so to speak. But elective procedure can be a lot of other things. There are a lot of things that are elective. I don't have to have this surgery. The doctor said I've got a 70% chance of living without it, but with the surgery, it brings it to 90. Or, you know, there's this new hepatitis C drug. It's, I think, $80,000, and it cures you in 3 months. That is elective. And if you ask the insurance companies, yeah, that's elective. We're not sure we're going to pay for that. It's not just elective in terms of physical enhancements. It may be other things as well. Support. So support and maintenance and reasonable comfort, considering their custom manner of living, and to assist them to start a trade or business or profession, remodel, expand, or purchase a residence. So just expanding on what do we mean by support. And the reason I specified in support the whole thing of starting a trade or business, because I think that is a form of support. It's a way to, you can support yourself. So if I help you with this, then you can, it's a form of being able to support yourself. And then education, same, similar to healthcare. Most people say, yeah, I want broad education. Liberally, to include all expenses of public or private education, so we don't get into that argument. Wait, they only meant this, not that. At all levels of school, wait, was this only for college? No, this is elementary school, can be just as expensive, if not more than college, depending where you go. Graduate, professional schools, specialized vocational training. Not everyone's going to go to college. And includes tuition fees, supplies, computers, and other equipment. And I'm sure people will laugh at that in the future. Computers, who uses that? So who knows what we'll add to this. I guess that's the other equipment line. Provision about avoiding foreign trusts. So these are just things to protect from inadvertent events. So if a trust is a U.S. trust and becomes a foreign trust, because it's administered by a non-U.S. trustee, for example, they pick their brother-in-law who lives in Belgium and isn't a U.S. citizen, then it becomes a foreign trust and it can trigger all the gains, unrealized gains in the trust. So we've put this provision in saying all substantial decisions of the trust. So this is, the regulations talk about substantial decisions of the trust being made by U.S. persons. If they're not, then it's a foreign trust and also subject to U.S. law. So we say, look, all substantial decisions. So if there is some trustee in here, and maybe the trustee was in the U.S. and then they moved away, and they didn't, we still have the same trustee. So if there is anyone in here, this is really a savings clause. They cannot participate in any substantial decisions as defined in the rules. Trustee power to allow beneficiary to use real property owned by the trust. So this is always just one of those questions that comes up all the time. It says health, education, support. So if the trust buys a house, can they live in there for free? Do they have to pay rent? What do we do here? And the trustee might say, it's not the greatest investment. So do we want to do that? Maybe if we charge them rent, that would be different, or have them pay the utilities. So we give the trustee the authority. And it says, upon such terms that the trustee deems advisable, with or without rent, or in consideration of paying the taxes, insurance, maintenance, repairs, and or otherwise. So basically, trustee, you can figure it out. You're authorized to do it either way, because it may make sense to buy it as an asset of the trust. It might not, and whether they want to charge rent or otherwise. Limitation on ability to acquire closely held businesses. So this came up when I was deposed. I learned years later the client named his brother as the trustee for his kids. The client passed away, and the brother invested the kids' trust funds in his business and didn't do so well. So under what circumstances can they? Because we want to have broad investment discretion, and closely held businesses may make a lot of sense. So now we've added the, they can't invest in a business in which they're involved as an owner, executive, or otherwise, unless they're in the family, so descendant, so siblings and so forth, or the beneficiary consents. Those are the main two scenarios. So look, if you're part of the family, or if the trust already owns part of it, hey, we already had it because dad had it, and so we're already in it, we're just going to expand perhaps, but putting some limitations on that. So authorizing trustee to pay third parties for services, we want to have that, make sure they're off, they can hire people for whatever purposes they need. Annual accountings can be a pain. So I like to basically, to the extent you can under state law, and it's going to vary, waive the right for an annual accounting unless the beneficiary requests it. So beneficiaries, you can request them whenever you want. Actually, I think we put a limitation. Can't do more than one or two per year, so don't ask one for every month because that can be burdensome. But instead of mandating one, and a trustee may choose to give an annual accounting in many cases, but instead of mandating it every time, you could say, look, it's only going to be upon the request of the beneficiaries, or the trustee can do it if they choose to. But again, limiting the trustee liability. So we're not doing them any favors. They're doing us a huge favor by being the trustee. So limiting trustee liability to gross negligence and willful wrongdoing, as opposed to just mere negligence. But you have to be careful. If you draft a trust and you're the trustee, that's going to be strongly construed against you unless you can show that you discussed that thoroughly with the client, document that, look, you're naming me as trustee, but I'm only going to be liable for these things. Same thing with the bank trustee. If they provide language, hey, here's the language we'd like to see, put it on page 12, and it reduces their liability in some way, it just needs to be clearly explained to the client, we understand where this came from, or it's going to be construed pretty strictly against you. So back to the concept of investment diversification. So waiver prudent person rule. I just want to give the trustee as much leeway to invest as possible, because, and especially if you have multiple trusts, and we cover this in my language here, you might have three different trusts. One is GST exempt, one's non-GST exempt, one's a marital trust, who knows? And do we need to, would we want to invest them all the same way? You know, this one we want more income, this one we want more growth for long term, or maybe we want a concentrated investment in the long term GST trust because that's how you create wealth. But if you have this duty to diversify everything, then you're going to have just diversified across the board, same investments across the board. Whereas the better thing would be to, as a whole, we're diversified. If you look at the family investments as a whole, but we've placed the right investments in the right buckets. We want the high growth here. We want the more taxable ones here. We want the ones generating more income over here. So placement is important. So if we can give the trustee flexibility to consider other trusts for the family in their investment allocation, that'll just give them more leeway to do that. Incapacity. So we've got a clause that says if a trustee or other fiduciary is incapacitated, they are deemed to have resigned. So we don't have to go into court and bring them up and show that they're incapacitated, and then they're removed, and then we can appoint a new trustee. But then we define incapacity, of course. So what is incapacity? They're a minor, okay, so I guess you couldn't be a trustee in the first place, or under other legal disability. So that's the scenario where you might be in court. They're incarcerated for more than 30 days. So the weekend stint in jail, you can still be trustee. You've been there 30 days, we need a new one. Whereabouts are unknown, and none of the beneficiaries can find them within, we put in 90 days. So, you know, lost at sea, went hiking, didn't come back, decided to move somewhere and didn't tell anybody, just left the grid. Okay, 90 days, we don't have to keep looking. We can get a new trustee. And then last is the more traditional. There's a letter from a doctor saying they've lost their marbles. Well, the problem is they might not go to the doctor. They say, you know, I'm not going to go to the doctor and get that letter. Why would I do that? So we say, well, the beneficiaries can ask them to produce a letter saying that they do know what they're doing. And if they don't produce that letter within 6 months, then they are out. So you can either go and get the letter and say, ha, I'm still your trustee, and now I hate all of you and you're not getting any money. Or they don't produce it and we kick them out. But again, we still have the other provisions I talked about earlier. Maybe we have a way to remove the trustee if they're a certain age and they're the right people. So I think defining capacity is important to stay out of court and avoid having long periods of time where we don't have a trustee for one reason or another. And then how trustees vote. So most state laws will govern this, but I hate deferring to state law, especially if you can change the state law in the document. So we say a decision by a majority will control. And obviously if there's two, then they both need to agree, so it's in effect unanimous. And those who dissent won't be liable. Hey, I didn't go with this. don't sue me over it. I voted against buying that stock. Paragraph R on 22, single signatory, is probably my most useful provision in the entire document. And that's the one that says, any one fiduciary can sign documents on behalf of all the fiduciaries, assuming they've agreed to the action. And this comes up daily. We're buying an insurance policy. Do I need both trustees to sign the application? We're opening a new bank account. Do I need both trustees? Yeah, I mean, it's not a bad idea to have both trustees, but we're signing a contract, we're buying an investment, we're closing on a house, whatever it may be. This says, and we can send this to the bank or whatever institution wants to see it, here's the language right out of page 20 in the trust. One trustee can sign on behalf of the others, unless the trustees say, you know what, I don't trust you, you aren't signing, and they've agreed that they won't do that. Transfers to similar trusts, this can come in handy. You've got two, three trusts that have been created over time, and they're all pretty much the same. They're created for different purposes at different times, and it's time to combine them. So let's put this one into that one, and that one into this one, and merge them. It's sort of a form of built-in decanting without a state law provision. We also allow, when the trustee is authorized to make discretionary distributions, equally or unequally, to transfer to a trust for one or two of the beneficiaries. So it doesn't necessarily have to be a trust for all the beneficiaries. Look, the trustee had the power to just give one of the beneficiaries a bunch of money. So why shouldn't they have the power to move some of the money to a trust with the same terms just for that beneficiary? So again, it can be a way of decanting without having to go through all the state law requirements. S-corp modification powers is just something we just always throw in the back. If the trust is ever going to acquire S-corp stock, foreseen or unforeseen, the trustee has the ability to modify the trust so it can qualify as a electing small business trust or qualify as subchapter S trust by limiting a power of appointment to being at death only or mandating all the income be paid out to the beneficiary so it can qualify under those rules. So it can come in handy if you want to acquire S-corp stock because otherwise the trust might not qualify. This conflicts waiver is... So it was requested, it came from the banks originally, when we have a bank trustee or a trust company, say, well, we want a waiver because, look, you came to us partly because you probably like what we do on managing the money, and we want to be able to use our products as opposed to we're the trustee and then we're shipping it out to someone else to do it. So we want to have this for that purpose, but it also serves the other purpose of you name the brother as the trustee, and by the way, he's a CPA, and that was one of the reasons we named him as the trustee. And it would kind of make sense if his firm did the tax work and the tax filings for the trust. So this says, yeah, we're waiving that conflict. So you can be a trustee and you can use your firm. It needs to be reasonable fees and so forth. But there won't be a conflict per se from using your own firm for that purpose. Disclaimers. So we know there's disclaimers under state law. So one can disclaim an asset that was put in the trust or an asset that comes to them from the trust, and we want to make sure that we want to say what happens, because sometimes the state law isn't clear. It doesn't apply to all these situations when there's a disclaimer, whether it's qualified or not, in a trust. So we say if someone disclaims an interest in the trust or an asset in the trust, they're treated as having deceased for purposes of that trust or that asset, and by the way, move the asset out of the trust to another one, so it is a qualified disclaimer. We build the provisions in so we can comply in more cases than we otherwise might. Virtual representation comes in handy all the time. So many states have statutes saying the oldest beneficiaries can represent the younger beneficiaries and the unborn beneficiaries, but not every state has that. So if we build it in the trust agreement, or not every state has exactly the language we'd want. So if we build in the trust agreement, we can authorize others to sign off and approve, whether it's accountings or consent to some action being taken by the trustee or otherwise. And maybe it doesn't necessarily have to be the beneficiaries. We can say the parent of the beneficiaries can do it, or of a minor or other incapacitated beneficiary. So again, I try to not rely on state law because state law can change. It may not be what we want. And again, they may change the situs or governing law. So GST provisions, a generic power to divide for GST purposes. Some state laws have this, some don't. So you have a trust, it was GST exempt. Someone put a bunch of assets in, they're not exempt. Can we segregate the trust? Can we divide the trust before that happens? We've got provisions saying, wait a minute, if assets are coming in, they're not exempt, we've got exempt assets. Trustee, you can divide the trust ahead of time and then put them into a separate trust. Or, of course, allows for qualified severances to divide a trust that's already got a mixed ratio. And then telling a trustee, by the way, if there's two trusts here, one is GST exempt, one is not, you can make distributions more from one or from the other. And you'd think our original clause said, trustee, make it from the non-exempt trust first. It's like, well, wait a minute, that's not always true. If this is for a grandchild, we want it from the GST exempt trust, and the non-exempt is going to trigger tax. So it depends who the beneficiary is, depends what we're trying to do here. So trustee, you can favor one or the other depending on the tax consequences of the distribution. It doesn't have to be equal or anything else across the board. A few more points, survivorship clause. So there's a predeceased parent exception in the GST rules, which means if assets are gifted or bequeathed to a grandchild, and the grandchild's parent, who is the child of the deceased person or the donor, is already gone, then the grandchild moves up a generation, and there's no GST tax. Normally, there'd be bequest or gift to a grandchild, there'd be a GST tax, went down to. The predeceased parent exception says, okay, the parent is gone, we'll move the child up, and there won't be a GST tax. Now, that rule applies also if in a testamentary setting. So if a person dies within 90 days, so grandparent dies, they leave assets to their child, the child dies within 90 days, and the trust instrument or will or state law says if they die within 90 days, it goes down to the grandchild, then the predeceased parent exception will apply, and there won't be a GST tax. But if it doesn't say that, if it says, I leave it to my child, and then it just goes through the child's estate. So there's a state tax there. There's a state tax again, perhaps. Then it gets down to the grandchild or maybe the spouse, wherever it's going to go. You wouldn't have that. So you can build into your documents a 90-day survivorship requirement. So if you survive by 90 days, you get the assets. If you don't, it goes to your kids. And if that actually happens, which we hope it doesn't, it would avoid the estate and the GST tax on that. But there's also another benefit in the GST rules, and that is you can have a six-month survivorship requirement. So you can say if they have to survive 6 months. So if they die within 90 days, we get the predeceased parent exception. If they die between 90 days and 6 months, you don't get that exception, but it'll be treated as a direct skip. So there's three types of GST transfers. And a direct testamentary direct skip is tax exclusive, versus the other types of GST transfers are inclusive. So the bottom line is the GST tax will be less. So we build in a six-month survivorship requirement. If they survive, great. They die within 90 days, we avoid the GST tax. If they die between 90 days and 6 months, we have a lower GST tax between the three. Unfortunately, none of the provisions have ever kicked in. Right to information. There's no rule that says, once you have set up a trust for your kids, that you get information about it. It's for the kids. So you can see the trustee saying, let's see, I don't see you as a beneficiary. Why would I give you an accounting? You want to know what the assets are and who are you? Oh, you're the donor, but you know, thanks for the assets. But so we put in a right to information, the donor spouse, and basically anyone who has the right to appoint or remove trustees. We want them to know what's going on. How do we know whether to remove the trustee and put a new one in? So give them a right to information under the trust document. And then last, you got to define every term. So by right of representation or per stirpes, what does that mean? And there's really two ways people can define it. They might say, I want it dividing at the children's level. And if a child's gone, then you know three kids, it'll be a third. But I've had some clients say, but wait a minute, but if all my children are gone, then I want it dividing at the grandchildren level. So if there's nine of them, I want 1/9. I don't want a third, a third, a third, and then this one only had one kid, and this one had five kids, and the grandkids get unequal amounts. So it's just another variation, another option to throw into the mix. So hopefully you got something out of this session this morning, and thank you for having me.